Good morning. Here I have a nichrome wire and a variable power supply, which will display both the electric potential difference across and current delivered by the power supply. What data would you need to collect, and what would need to go on the axes of a graph such that the resistivity of nichrome would be the slope of the straight best fit line of the data?
Flipping physics.
What is a nichrome wire?
Oh, sorry. It's a wire made of nichrome. Nichrome is a metal which is an alloy of nickel and chromium, hence nichrome.
Thanks.
So you want us to figure out what data we need on the x and y axes of a graph such that the slope of the straight best fit line of the data is the resistivity of nichrome.
Yes, Billy, that is exactly it.
Well, from Ohm's law, we know resistance equals electric potential difference divided by current.
We need resistivity in the equation. We know resistance is also equal to resistivity times length divided by cross-sectional area.
So we multiply the whole equation by current and cross-sectional area to remove all variables from denominators. So now we have electric potential difference times cross-sectional area equals resistivity times current times length.
How does that help us figure out what we need on the x and y axes?
Because we know the slope-intercept form of a straight line is y equals mx plus b.
Y equals slope times x plus y-intercept.
Right.
Okay, I get it. So comparing that to our original equation means we put electric potential difference times cross-sectional area on the y-axis, slope is the resistivity, current times length is on the x-axis, and the y-intercept equals zero.
That means all we need to do is vary the length of the wire and measure current through and electric potential difference across the wire, and we can get the resistivity of nichrome.
But we do need the diameter of the wire to get the cross-sectional area of the wire.
Yeah, we do need that.
Correct so far. Thanks. So this nichrome wire is a 32-gauge wire, which means according to American wire gauge standards, the wire has a diameter of 0.202 millimeters and a radius which is half that, or 0.101 millimeters, or 0.000101 meters. With that, and knowing the cross-sectional area of the wire has the shape of a circle, we can determine the cross-sectional area. It equals pi times radius squared, or pi times 0.000101 squared, which equals 3.20474 times 10 to the negative 8 meters squared. And now we can collect data.
Mr. P?
Yes, Bobby?
Remember to start with the longest length of wire.
Why?
Yeah, why do we need to start with the longest length wire?
Because we cannot make the wire longer after we cut it to its shortest length.
Oh.
We do not actually need to cut the nichrome wire. When we say the length of the nichrome wire, what we mean is the effective length of the nichrome wire, which is the distance between the two alligator clips on the wire. In other words, okay, so we have the black and red wires which are attached to the terminals of the power supply. On the other end of the red wire is this alligator clip, and I'm going to attach the alligator clip at this specific point on the wire. So right now, even though there is an electric potential difference between the two terminals of the power supply, there's no current shown on the power supply because there's no current flowing through the circuit because there is no closed loop right now. So even though there is this electric potential difference across the power supply, there's no current in the circuit. But when I touch the alligator clip, the black alligator clip, to the nichrome wire, current then flows through the circuit because the circuit is now a closed loop. However, realize the current only goes through the portion of the nichrome wire which is between the two alligator clips. So to change the effective length of the nichrome wire, all I have to do is to move the black alligator clip, move where it touches the nichrome wire. So now the new effective length is between those two alligator clips. Bobby, does that make sense?
Yeah. Sorry about that.
It's okay, I didn't really get it either.
It's absolutely fine, Bobby, no worries. All right, let's collect some data. Let's start at 45 centimeters, where we get an electric potential difference of 9.6 volts and a current of 0.53 amps. At 40 centimeters, we get 8.7 volts and 5.4 amps. At 35 centimeters, it is 7.6 volts and 0.53 amps. At 30 centimeters, it's 6.8 volts and 0.54 amps. At 25 centimeters, 5.6 volts and 0.52 amps. 20 centimeters, 4.8 volts and 0.53 amps. 15 centimeters, 3.4 volts, 0.49 amps. 10 centimeters, 2.3 volts, 0.44 amps. 5 centimeters, 1.2 volts, 0.36 amps. Now, before we finish the data table and create the graph, let me show you why I decreased the electric potential difference as the length decreased. This is what happens when I try to put an electric potential difference of 9.4 volts across 5 centimeters of this nichrome wire. First off, the variable power supply maxes out at 2.04 amps, so the power supply reduces the electric potential difference to roughly 5.7 volts. But look at what happens to the 5 centimeter length of wire.
It turns red. Why does that matter?
It turns red because the wire gets very hot.
Why does it matter if the wire gets hot?
He might burn himself?
Sure, there is that, but there is also a physics reason.
Resistivity is temperature dependent. In conductors, the resistivity increases as the temperature of the material increases. You want to keep the temperature of the nichrome wire as constant as possible.
Right, so you decrease the electric potential difference as you decrease the effective length of the nichrome wire because the resistance of the wire decreases with decreased length.
And because electric power equals electric potential difference squared over resistance, if you kept the electric potential difference the same, as the resistance decreased, the electric power would increase. In other words, the rate at which the nichrome wire converts electric potential energy to heat, light, and sound would increase, therefore increasing the temperature of the wire and increasing the resistivity of the wire. And we do not want the resistivity of the nichrome wire changing as we measure it.
Absolutely. Notice how at 5.7 volts and 2.04 amps, the nichrome wire basically acts like a filament of an incandescent light bulb, because that's what the filament of an incandescent light bulb is. It's a wire with a large electric potential difference across it, converting electric potential energy to heat, light, and sound. In an incandescent light bulb, the wire is made of tungsten and not nichrome, but the idea is the same.
Got it. An incandescent light bulb has a tungsten wire in it, which glows as it converts electric potential energy to heat, light, and sound.
Yes. Now let's complete our data table and graph. We already have values for electric potential difference, current, length, and cross-sectional area. At this point, all we need to do is multiply electric potential difference times cross-sectional area to get the data we need for the y-axis, and multiply current times length to get the data we need for the x-axis. Then we plot that information on our graph and add our straight best fit line and an equation for our straight best fit line. And the equation we get is y equals 1.2 times 10 to the negative 6 times x plus 2.1 times 10 to the negative 8. In other words, for our nichrome wire, electric potential difference times cross-sectional area equals 1.2 times 10 to the negative 6 times current times length plus the y-intercept. That means the resistivity we get for nichrome is 1.2 times 10 to the negative 6 ohm meters. According to the physics factbook, the resistivity of nichrome at 20 degrees Celsius is in the range of 1.0 to 1.5 times 10 to the negative 6 ohm meters. I think we can definitely say the physics works. The physics works, the physics works. The physics works, the physics works. Yeah.
But is it 20 degrees Celsius in here?
Yes, Mr. P keeps the classroom at 68 degrees Fahrenheit in the winter, which is the same as 20 degrees Celsius.
Good. Just checking.
But what about the y-intercept? I thought the y-intercept was supposed to be zero. Why is it not zero?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so the y-intercept has a small positive value instead of zero, most likely because the black and red wires do not have zero resistance. The electric potential difference displayed on the power supply is the electric potential difference across the terminals of the power supply. We assumed the electric potential difference between the two alligator clips at the nichrome wire was the same as the electric potential difference across the terminals of the power supply. That would only be true if the black and red wires have zero resistance. Hopefully you recognize that is not quite true. In reality, they do have small resistances, which means the electric potential difference between the two alligator clips is a little bit smaller than what we measured and makes the y-intercept not quite equal to zero.
Got it. Thank you, Mr. P.
You are welcome, Bobby. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.